Bleach episode 18, Rages at Ringside, was probably our first episode that could be considered as high action, high animated, and one of many that are going to be coming throughout the core. There's a lot to say on this episode, but thankfully this review won't be as long as the other ones because it is pretty straightforward in its execution, to which makes things so much easier for me. So, as we go on through this review, please hit that like and subscribe and hit that comment in the comment section down below if you like these reviews, because there's some things I have to say about this episode in general. So, with that being said, let's get into it, shall we? First and foremost, I want to get right into the appreciation of the original content at the very start of the episode. Now, what I mean by this is that we actually get to see what a war feels like. And in the manga, we didn't really get this kind of what some might consider as filler. Because in the manga, it's very much one-on-one fights or two-on-one fights and fights and fights and fights going on in general. But we don't really get to see what's happening in the background, to which we get at the start of this episode. Especially with Mayuri communicating with Kyoraku, telling him to get his reinforcements all together, get more to the barracks, etc. But that's not the thing that interests me the most. It's actually the topography of the Soul Society itself. Yes, the area has changed, much like Shuhei has mentioned before when he met up with Ikkaku and Yumichika, but it's really interesting to see the map of what the Soul Society looks like, and you could even class it as world building to some extent. So it's really interesting to see these put into motion, and especially talking with the many other reinforcements and the already no-name Soul Reapers actually doing something, even if it's healing or being reinforcements or just being supporting characters, because it makes it feel like the war is, again, as I've said in previous episodes, alive. Some might jest of the fact that how Mayuri talked to Kyoraku during this time, but in regards to how Mayuri speaks to Kyoraku, is that when I think about it, is that yeah, even though there was sarcasm or sass from Mayuri's part, is that in this war, there is really no superiority in terms of class in this regard. It is a war. Everyone's on the same level. Everyone has to achieve the same goal here. So regardless of the fact that there is lieutenants and there is captains, that's only really by strength at this moment in time. So to see Mayuri kind of talk to Kyoraku on the level, they're talking on a middle ground. And I kind of like that aspect of things. But regardless of what, the episode starts off very explosively with Kensei versus Master Masculine, of course Rose being there as well, and I have to say I appreciate the episode from start to finish because a lot of it was action heavy, regardless of whether it was Kensei or Rose, there was action there and there was some nice great animation going on within those fights. Kensei, especially when we first see him achieve his Bankai transformation, looked beautiful, really appreciated that, and the moment he goes to attack Mask with that punch felt really impactful and really heavy, and that's something that the Thousand Blood War is doing really well, is it's making its impacts feel like they're hitting. Whether it's through sound effects, whether it's through camera angles, camera motion, and animation in general, they always feel like it's actually feeling something. So it is a great way to start off that episode with Kensei throwing in that punch with Master Masculine. Then of course, as this is all going down, especially as Kensei has literally thrown Mask over to a building, Shuhei does actually wake up slightly to say the problem isn't Mask and the problem is actually James, to which Kensei then does get absolutely obliterated by an amazing impact frame, if you want to call it impact frame, of Mask waking up and then suddenly just high speed attacking Kensei. Comes down, hits Kensei, blasts him into a wall, and with no time lost, goes straight for Rose as well. And it felt quick, it felt reactionary, and it didn't really, I don't know what the word is, but it didn't really like take its time to actually like for Mask to kind of recuperate himself. He just went straight in for it, which, you know, this is an enemy, this is a fight. There is no dilly-daddling, right into it. And I like that about Mask in this specific shot. In these shots in particular, I did like the fact that it wasn't just one camera perspective of Kensei getting hit. It was actually two, one for the face and then another camera angle to the face as well. And then you get to see Kensei going as well as Rose as well getting hit as well. And his tumbling as he goes onto the ground felt very human and very realistic. And I like that a lot. Then of course, Kensei recovers and then goes in for more shots on Mask, which I like the fact that of his Bankai, like it really shows like these like kind of prongs on his fist. And anytime those prongs kind of like they retract into the fist, the moment it makes contact means it's like as soon as those prongs go into the fist, it's like the activation means that it's connected. And those hits, of course, the moment that the longer the fist is on Mask or the opponent in general, the force of that first initial shot will continue to keep hitting and hitting. And I think the anime did a really good job with this because realistically, there's no movement within this attack, right? You have to make this attack feel like motion is happening through either sound effects or camera angles, to say. So they could have just gone with a still frame of them yelling each other with speed lines, to which they did to some certain degree, but they also changed the camera from like a close-up shot to a faraway shot as well, and seeing kind of like the air being distorted as well. So I appreciate, for something as limited as Kensei's ability, they managed to make it seem like there was still motion happening within those scenes. But of course, as James cheers, the stronger that mask gets, and of course Kensei didn't really last long. And I did love that headbutt to the face, because again, these shots are feeling impactful, and Kensei of course gets taken out, to which Rose takes advantage of this. He says he takes advantage of this, kills James, well, seemingly kills James, slices him in half, and then goes into Bankai himself, to which is interesting because it is CG. The whole Bankai is CG. And I was thinking about whether I would prefer it if it was drawn or CG, but I feel like the whole optical illusion effect with Rose's Bankai, to be drawn, would have to be drawn meticulously. Because with optical illusions, the way the eyes work, everything has to kind of somewhat be, in my view anyway, somewhat symmetrical for the eyes to kind of be distorted a little bit. And the only way you're going to keep that really consistent is with CG. And again, the CG makes it look alien, it makes it look unfamiliar, and I feel like that works with this, again, specific Bankai. And it obviously keeps consistency with the lines, of course, of the optical illusion of Rose's Bankai. So I do think it works better with CG for now. I think it does work, and I think it was probably the best design choice. Of course, you're welcome to disagree. I'm sure many people will, but that's just my preference in regards to the whole thing and why I prefer it. Now, while this Bankai is playing, it is interesting, and I had to really listen as watching this scene quite a few times, but it did seem that Sagasu did use the OST for Here to Stay, especially at the start of the Bankai special. I don't know throughout the rest of it, but at the start you do hear the chimes of na 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 na, and it was really good because I personally didn't notice it at first. I know someone like Rebirthed it, but like I didn't notice it at first. And I don't know why that OST specifically from Sagasu. I feel like that's more of like a sad OST, but I think it worked as well. I did like the variation of it. And of course, I did think the Bankai in general looked really cool, especially with the water effects. The fire effects went really good. I did genuinely enjoy the fire effects throughout all this, and the motion of the Bankai itself. So I think Rose did get a little bit of justice, and I feel like it teased enough of Rose's Bankai to not fully give everything that it's capable of doing, especially with like the third act, where we didn't really get to see it because obviously by this time Master Masculine has already ruptured his earlobe. So, you know, there's still more for Rose's Bankai that we've still yet to see, and I think it is a nice teaser because we don't really know how strong Rose is. We only get like a smidgen of its potential, so to say. So I'm not going to rule out Rose as being like weak yet. Now, of course, people want to say like put on the mask. There's questions as to why they don't. I have my somewhat kind of guesses, but I guess that is for like another video in general. We will get to see masks within this core. So again, let's see where the anime goes with this, and maybe their explanation to it. Maybe it will be thrown in there. So I'm kind of holding off kind of that criticism off for now. But all in all, I did enjoy the Bankai. Unfortunately, Bleach does fall into this idea, and I think Shinji is the worst of it. But majority of the time, most of the Bankais that we see throughout in Bleach happen within the Soul Society arc. So a lot of the Bankais are explained to us. So when, you know, people like Toshiro or people like Byakuya, they don't really need to explain their Bankais later on in the series, because we as the audience already kind of know what it does and what its concept is. However, for people like, you know, Rose, where we haven't seen it before, we do have to get as an audience that explanation. But this isn't new in Shonen at all. I mean, Gojo does it all the time when he's explaining his ability to enemies. Unfortunately, like, his ability is just so OP that it doesn't really matter. But we do fall under the same concept of like, okay, well, this is what it does, but in order to tell us what it does, he has to tell the enemy, and bing bang bosh, it falls under the Jabba category where the enemy can kind of, you know, counteract it. And I understand that that is a flaw within Bleach sometimes, depending on the character, but hey, at least, you know, we get an explanation on Rose's Bankai, and I quite like it, to be honest with you. Unfortunately, the flaw is, of course, that Master the Masculine does, in fact, rupture his eardrums, to which, you know, people are like, Rose, shut the fuck up, why did you tell him that? And to be honest with you, if I was a captain and I was explaining what my ability does, I wouldn't, because I'm not silly. But who in the Bleach series, as an enemy, are you actually expecting them to instinctively, like, rupture their eardrums? Like, I don't think anyone that is sane would actually do that. So it is quite surprising for an enemy to actually go to that levels of extreme. Of course, in Mask's case, I don't think he really cared because he had James and he could be healed, so I guess he had that to go. But if it was any other enemy, I doubt that they would actively do that to themselves because they don't have like that back burner to fix themselves afterwards. So, I mean, just skill diff, ain't it, really? And then following right after that, we get Rose get hit with a big beam of light in the shape of a star and it goes right through him. And again, the one thing I do like about Mask is that he is not playing around. Like, if he wants to do something, he's just going to do it. He's not going to play with the enemy. I had to think about that. No, Mask isn't playing with the enemy at all. He's doing what he needs to do right off the bat, which is really cool. And the fact that, like, even when he saw, like, a finger twitch from Rose, he went for the shot again. And again, the light felt fast. The attack felt fast. It felt like it was unreactionary. And it just goes to show that Mask is, even though he's goofy, quite a strong opponent you don't want to deal with. And then, of course, we end off the first half with Renji actually saving Rose in this regard. And then we get Rukia looking cute in her ski gear. I love Rukia. Anything that she wears is just adorable. Even when she's trying to act serious. Adorable. Lovable. She takes one good look at Mask. The question is does Mask find Rukia attractive considering he gave her that really creepy smile? But regardless of what, Rukia looked at Mask in disappointment and said, yeah, like, You're more than enough for him. So off she went, carried Rose and Kensei, which was an original scene as well, to which I liked as well, because obviously this wasn't shown. And again, I guess I understand from Kubo's perspective where his health was, where his kind of mindset was. He couldn't put all these little details within the manga. So it's kind of nice to get like this extra feeling of again, war. And I feel like Core 2 is being really repetitive with kind of showing that. And I really appreciate it, of showing what war is and showing that there is casualties and there is emergencies to people's life and death situations. And then, of course, that's when we get into the idea of Isane and the rest of Squad 4 also healing, of course, a bunch of soldiers. Now, the area is a lot different compared to in the manga, because in the manga we get to see Isane like within a building. This one seems like it's in a bunch of ruins. So is that going to change when it comes to the Gremi fight potentially? We'll have to see if she does change destination, or in fact it does stay where they currently are at the moment. Of course, there's some issues here and there with the Renji fight as a whole, which I don't really have that much of a problem with, and I'll explain later on. But of course, Renji goes straight for James after slicing Master Masculine, because obviously James is his power. And the problem with killing or hurting James in this regard is that he can in fact multiply. And the problem is with multiplying James is that the more fans there are of Mask, the more stronger he gets, because the more cheers, the more strength. So instead of having one fan, he has multiple fans now. So in retrospect, maybe not killing James is the way forward. You'd rather kill them both at the same time. Now, this is where there's some panels from the manga that wasn't adapted within this episode. But in substitution, we do get a lot of creative liberty in replacement for those scenes. For example, with Master Masculine absolutely blitzing Renji through a bunch of buildings, X, Y, and Z. This was extended. Now, of course, like, instead of Renji, like, grabbing a punch and stopping Mask from, like, hurting him, in this sense, we get to see Mask absolutely go ham on Renji and Renji just not being fazed. Unfortunately, and this is, like, a critique, it's also kind of appreciated in the same suit, is that sometimes some high animation shots are so fast that you can't really see the details, especially on your first attempt of watch. Right, so many of you will probably see Renji get hit and then his facial features will not actually be shown because like it's so fast paced. But when you actually like boil it down and you actually like go a little bit slower, you get to see that Renji is getting hit and his face is just completely deadpanned. Sure, there's some reactions of him like getting hit into a building, but that's more somewhat of uncomfortableness rather than like hurt, because you just don't see any damage on the guy whatsoever. There is some, of course, things in the manga that I do appreciate, like Renji grabbing onto a building as he's being pushed back and then the building breaking, but again, I'm completely fine. Yeah, I do prefer the manga a little bit, but what we got, I ain't gonna complain about it either, because it looked good and I appreciate it. For example, like the star coming down on the ground, like it made this like star crater. And did we get that in the anime? No. But did it take away from the impact? No. Do I prefer it in the manga? Yeah. But do I hate the way that they did it? No. So speaking of the actual star itself, when obviously Mask went Volstandig, is that this star was created, beautifully animated by the way. The colours are amazing, and if you actually pause at the star, you get to see all the cool little details within the middle as well. When this thing comes down, and this makes me really excited for the meteor shot with Gremi, but when this star comes down, it felt like there was such resistance and weight as it was falling that it just made it feel like it was powerful. Of course, James got bodied, and this is obviously another one of Mask's ignorance of where he thought he was so powerful that he had defeated Renji right there and then, because he believed that, oh, if I exist, then James will always exist over time and he will come back eventually. So he kind of nerfed himself in that regard. But I absolutely love, again, Sagasu's music with this because it felt so hellish. And then we finally get Renji's new and improved Bankai. Of course, if you guys don't know, as Ichibei said, Renji has always been using his Bankai at half a name. And in order to use his Bankai at its full name, Renji has to make his, obviously, Zanpakuto to acknowledge his strength, to which Ichibei said, we're going to be doing right now. So that training was less about Renji, I guess, training per se, but more about trying to make his Bankai acknowledge that he's worthy of using it. So I am glad that Ichibei doesn't just tell him the Bankai name and then he automatically just gets to use it. I'm glad that he has to kind of prove it to Zabimaru himself. But yeah, I overall just enjoyed the scene. I enjoyed how it formed into what it is, with the monkey paw going onto the shoulder and then folding, and then of course the sword coming out of Zabimaru's mouth. I did just enjoy everything about that. It looked cool, it looked fantastic, and yeah, the monkey neuron in my brain kind of acted activated of like, oh, this is like Renji's time to shine. It was like really cool. I enjoyed it. You saw the reaction, you know, it's there. And then we have like a new OST that we're all calling apparently number two. Regardless of what Sagasu calls it, we're calling it number two because it's Hazel Fernandez again, who did the OST for number one, or Ichigo's his theme. And then, of course, this sounds very similar to number one, so everyone's calling it number two. It didn't feel like it should have been there, but it was oddly fitting at the same time. So it's like Shinji's theme, like with Bambietta. It's like it just felt weird, but oddly fitting as well. So I don't know. What do I know about music, right? However, I will say throughout this fight and throughout much of the episode in general, I do feel there is going to be Blu-ray corrections. And what I mean by that is that, actually, I'll talk about that in a second because I'll give an example. Because next we have the momentum of Zabimaru as Renji comes in to go towards Mask. And as he pierces him, Mask's whole body just like folds into Renji. And then obviously we have that big kind of snake thing just completely obliterates Mask into dust, which was really fitting because the thing that I loved the most was the actual like penetration and then the twist of the wrist. I don't know, they just just felt so fucking powerful, that dude, just like the oof. It felt like it was just opening like this massive padlock and it just felt so impactful. So I love that. It felt like, yeah, it just clicked for me. So what I mean by the Blu-ray corrections, I feel, is that especially when Mask was disintegrating, you see Renji's arm like almost at a 90 degree angle, and then obviously he moves it down, and then the next shot where you see Mask's whole body, his arm's like back up to 90 degrees. So there was many times in this episode where I saw cuts like that where the body was in one position and then it moved to another, and that's fine, like it's not a big deal, these corrections can happen fairly quickly and fairly simply. But I also felt, and maybe this is just me, and I do want to ask you guys in the comments, is do you felt like in this episode there was a lot of scenes or cuts that were just really zoomed in? I felt like some scenes were just too close to the face, or too close to an attack, or a reaction that wasn't fully in frame. And I had this with the Kensei fight, the one where Mask was making a start, and especially where Renji was grabbing Mask with the baboon hand. I felt like there was a lot of zoomed in shots which felt unnecessarily zoomed in, and I'm not sure if that was like on purpose or if they're hiding a frame that isn't completed yet. I'm not sure, I just got that vibe, but I definitely feel like this episode is going to get the Blu-ray treatment, which is fine because I think the episode is pretty solid in and of itself. So again, we saw episode 6 get mad improvements that didn't really think was necessary, to be honest with you, but they did it and it looked better than it already did. So I was very impressed with what they did in Core One's Blu-ray. But this, I feel like, again, another solid episode. I'm really interested to see what Blu-ray corrections they're going to make and see if me noticing the zoomed in shots were in fact apparent or not. Or maybe it's just me, I don't know. But then the end credits comes and we get back to Yuha Baha. We get a switch up because this time we get to see fundamentally what this end credits was essentially about, and that was the potential of Yuha's weakness. Now, of course, he absorbs James, which if you guys don't know, James is the real Sturmritter S. He is the one that controls Mass, so Master Masculine isn't the Sturmritter, but in fact, it is in fact James. So shoutouts to my homie. Gone but never forgotten, of course, the goat of the core. But yeah, Yuha absorbs him, he goes into the shadows and kind of transfers or switches with Harshwald, which Harshwald explains that, of course, him and Yuha are connected, or he corrects himself and says him and all the Sturmritter are corrected, but he chooses him to switch out when he goes into his sleeping mode, and he says something very specific, that Yuha's sleep should not be disturbed or interrupted, which goes to say that this is his weak or focal point of weakness. He explains that he's going to be telling Uryu about who Yuha is, and that someone like Sokan never really figured it out, so we get a Sokan cameo, and that was really cool. So it seems that we're left on this cliffhanger of Harshwald telling us what Yuha is, and that's probably going to be potentially the next episode. Now, I imagine because of the chapter that's after this, it is going to be the explanation of Yuha as a baby and what Yuha is to the people and how he gives abilities to people. Now, we already had this at the very first episode of Core 1. So are we rehashing that? Are we going more into detail about it? I did think that we were going to be doing that at some point, but I'm very interested if we're just going to be rehashing those scenes or we're just going to be showing exactly what happened in that chapter. And also in the chapter as well, we get to see Yuha's name with the black ink that Ichibei tried to cover up his name for like the longest time. I wonder if the anime does adapt that chapter or that scene as a whole. I wonder if, you know, Taguchi is going to attempt to show those black ink brushes around Yuha's name, because I feel like that's kind of important and that's something Kubo kind of spread out for the majority of the series. So that's my thoughts on this episode of Bleach, and I can't wait. I do really want to talk about episode 20 at some point, and just the pacing of the anime in general. But until then, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. Be nice, and as always, people, peace out.